Drink. This is James Christos right here, and you know, I need to learn to not speak for people. So, okay. If you want to introduce, however you feel comfortable, you know, say we'll just pass this back and forth.
We'll just pass the mic.
Yeah, yeah, we're real efficient. You know, we're trying to be green around here. We only want to have one mic at a time.
You know what I'm saying? Conserving. James Christos, as he said. I mean, what? That's
I mean,
who I am.
James Christos, like, you know, that's what I'm saying. You're a worthwhile individual, human being. Yeah, but what is it that what's your passion currently in life? Let's talk like that.
Passion currently in life is just to use the gifts and talents God's given me to provide for my family. I mean, that's my real passion. I mean, just whatever talents I got, you know, it just happens to be music in the forefront right now.
How about you just hold it?
I got it.
You're good at that.
Somewhat.
So what are those talents right now? Like, which ones are you focusing on? Because, in my opinion, as someone who isn't part of your family, it seems as though
you're part of the extended family. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Come on, man. Don't short yourself.
That was part of my question, actually. Okay. What is the extent of your family? Because I was going to ask you about certain people that you've been family with, I guess, for a long time. Right. How do you define that? Who are some of the, not to name everybody, not to leave people out, but what does that look like for you?
I mean, you know, besides my actual family, you know, my wife and four kids or whatever, you know, yourself, I guess I'll call him Jamal now, because, you know what I'm saying, you know, he's Jamal.
He's going to come up a lot on this show.
Oh, he is? Okay.
He'll be up here sometime, hopefully. Okay, physically, okay. I'm saying in conversation.
Right, you know what I'm saying, yeah. Joe Good, you know, Gun Jack, Nisha, I mean, really the whole hip-hop community that's been kind of doing their thing since like maybe like late 90s or something. Not to exclude anybody after that, but just that's like who I'm like connected to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
So that's basically it, you
no
know?
Doubt. Well, but I mean, I'll just get to the chase, I guess. I envision you as a performer, an entertainer, a lyricist. I don't want to put you in a box, because another thing I want to get to is well, let's keep it broad, because this show is for people in Kansas City. It's Kansas City centric, but it's around the world. You know, I know people. You know,
yeah, you do, because I'm gonna ask you about that too, man. Because I'm like a double sided interview. You know what I'm saying?
No, I figured it. I actually thought it'd be that much with you.
Okay.
Because as you can tell, ladies and gentlemen, Christos has some energy, and both of us are very tired right now. I won't tell you what time it is, but it's late enough that we both look tired. But we care so much about things in general, maybe, that we were like, you know, let's knock this out.
Exactly.
I'm going to try and get to my list of to-dos, but...
All right.
Because I try to prepare. Miles Bonney Show is trying to get its act together. All right, let's talk about some things.
All right.
Let's see if any of these make sense as a next question. So people, granted, it's not about comparisons. Right. Are there certain artists that you respect, that you are currently enjoying? It doesn't even have to be like shouts to them as much as, how about this? What is it you respect in a creative force?
I'll answer that, and then I'll try to be as specific as possible as far as who. In a creative force, man, I mean, really myself, since I'm from the Bay Area and I've been living in Kansas City and traveled.
When did you come out to Kansas City? Because I didn't realize.
Man, I moved here, I guess it would be 94, 93.
Okay.
That's when I moved here and just didn't go anywhere else.
All right, cool.
Graduated from Grandview, you know, my last 2 years. You know what I'm saying? So pretty much that's what it is. But, I mean, really, creative forces that influenced me or that I respect right now are just, man, the thing about it, man, there's a lot of good stuff right now as far as, like, even musically,
break it down,
you know what I'm saying? Musically,
not
just,
view it that way.
There's a lot of good stuff. I mean, specifically, like, one person I can name, like, Santa Gold, right? I mean, just...
What is it you like about Santa Gold?
You know, I just like, for me, from my perspective, and this might be like, I don't think it'd be over anybody's head, but for me, like, a lot of times, man, in urban music, you know what I'm saying? Like, which hip hop is mostly known, even if you're doing some way out stuff, it's still considered somewhat urban.
Right.
Like, people are afraid to venture out and do things that aren't really normally associated with hip hop or the culture of hip hop, whatever, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
And I feel like even though she doesn't specifically do like straight hip hop music, like her style is reflected by, you know, the culture and the kind of sound she comes out for like what a black female would do R&B wise or hip hop is nothing like. So I respect that. I respect people that aren't afraid to really just go out and challenge the status quo, do something different. Like you said earlier, you were like, I don't want to put you in a box, and it'd almost be impossible to do that, because every time I get in one, I disappoint people when I come out with the next project. You know what I'm saying? They're like, that doesn't sound like, you know what I'm saying? But I'm like, I'm an artist, man. You know what I'm saying? So
I mean, granted, you know, we could be real abstract about who you are to the public, but I'm thinking, because people have no idea who you are, you know, because despite the fact this is the third Miles Bonney show, and it's been very hip hop so far, because that's largely what I'm involved in. But eventually, we're going to branch out, and in conversation, I like to branch out, but. Most people probably consider you a rapper,
right?
For, you know, in terms of their whatever they know about you. I was going to say, how are you more than a rapper? But that's just like a stupid question that you could ask anybody. But what is? I mean, I've seen you on stage with just a dude with a guitar for a period of time.
Right.
Now you have this single called Punk Rock, which is like the main push out there, and I dig it. The more I listen to it, I liked it at first, but like you said, it's so hard for most people to probably keep up with you because you change styles, you have a lot of interests. Here's my question. I got to go shut that door real quick, but what inspires you to keep transitioning?
Really, the thing about it is, I mean, I don't think any... Oh, see what the drink does? He's got the drink in the hand.
I just started. That has to do with... my lack of balance. I was trying Wii Fit, and that told me my balance is off. Shouts to Mona.
Yeah, my wife's trying to get me on that, but I'm like, you know, I think I'll just do shows to stay in shape. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But you spend a lot of time behind the wheels and a trumpet, and you know what I'm saying? But I've seen you... Now, you say I have energy, but I've seen you perform, and it's like...
What is it?
This is the type of dude that you really don't want him DJing and stuff like that, because if he like decides to get like a wild hair and come out, you're gonna be competing with the dude that's supposed to be like, you know what I'm saying, give you the music, you know, the background, you know what I'm saying?
So are you basically asking me to apologize to Jamal now for all those years of me being a little too wild?
Nah. Not asking you to apologize, definitely not.
That hesitation I think answered the question.
I'm not though, because he was, you know, Jamal had energy, but I mean, you guys, especially together, man. I mean,
I gotta say, if nothing else, I was definitely... We're talking about the era when I was part of Sounds Good. That's basically referring to where I was a producer. For all the people that don't know me past 2006, before I was a background guy. Like, I was kind of ended up being hype man.
So
I didn't really rap. I didn't really perform, but I was like screaming whatever Joe Good was rapping, who was also Jamal. And that was I felt like that was my duty, was like create the energy, because he was so like precise with the lyrics. And for all those that are uninformed, look for Sounds Good. Biscuits and Gravy is our second album, blah, blah. Released another one this year of other old
music. In other words, he's still getting revenue from that, so go ahead and support that.
Yeah, and or like point of reference, you know. But anyway,
I forgot.
Well,
I forgot what
we're talking about. Oh, your transitions. From why?
Well, I mean,
why does James Christos change?
The same reason you stop being a quote unquote hype man. I mean, you can't be contained.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, well, you can't be contained.
But my group disbanded.
Yeah, but it was gonna happen anyways. It was better to happen that way than some ugly thing where you guys like have like $1 million and stuff, and then it gets ugly, and then you're on VH1.
And then I'm jumping out of planes, hoping to land in Jamaica and marry someone so I can avoid tax fraud or something.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? That type of thing. I mean, you know, like I tell people all the time, you know, you can't give an artist a paintbrush and think he's gonna paint the same picture every time. They don't expect visual artists to do that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, how bored would you get if you saw like one of my favorite artists, okay, Matisse, he has like a certain style, right?
What is it like about Matisse?
It's I mean, really the vagueness of the pictures, really. You know what I'm saying? Like the I don't know if he was considered to be part of the Fauve? It was I forgot what the term of the actual style of art was, but it was kind of like they use a lot of subjects that were kind of like so like primitive, I guess, or whatever. But I mean, even though he may have had a certain style, I mean, every picture is different, you know what I'm saying? So that's how I feel about it. And like I said, I just like music. If I hear something that inspires me, I'm like a sponge when it comes to music, you know what I'm saying? So like, if I hear something inspired, I'm like, man, that's dope. I want to make something like that.
So what inspired Punk Rock as a new song? I only say that because, and part of the reason I wanted you on the show is because you make noise, and I appreciate that. As you know, obviously I enjoy making noise just for the fun of it, really. But it's energy is what creates that noise, and your current energy is focused behind a song called Punk Rock.
Tell
people about Punk Rock, like where'd it come from. I was wondering who produced it, like all that. I'm not gonna look at this because I don't know what these icons are on the screen.
Oh, it's
smiley face. It looks okay.
That means we're good.
Smiley man. Face must be good. So if anyone owns a Sony old school camera and has a smiley face on it, I hope that means it's okay.
And people will continue to call you even though you tell them you're gonna be on the Miles Bonney show.
You know, but you know, Miles Bonney show. Is that a speaker?
Yep. Hold on. Yo.
Say what's up. Did you hang up on?
Yep. I did. That was Rusty Shackleford, aka my boy Rashad, you know, Dreads.
Oh, no, Buffy. No. Yeah. Oh, we gotta get Rashad on the show.
But,
he's got some good records.
He's like one of your, like, biggest fans, you know, and he's like,
I don't have fans.
A semi-stalker.
Friends. No, he's not.
He'd be like, man, you know.
I show up at his place for employment all the time. Ask him questions he can't answer.
Right. Well, I mean, as far as the punk rock things, like, well, the single that's out right now is the punk rap single.
Oh, and like, I don't even know about that.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? That's what I gave you. I hate it. I think he's calling back. No, he's not calling. Oh, okay.
You should call him.
The whole thing is, we'll call him first. The whole thing is just like, you know, the punk rap with the punk rap scene was like, I don't really try to get into gimmicks, you know what I'm saying? Stuff like that.
What would you call a gimmick? Not to sound anybody else.
No, a gimmick to me is something that you deliberately take an idea and say, we're going to label this, whatever we're doing, with this, and we're going to push it specifically for these reasons.
Like extreme marketing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, just very consciously doing, you know what I'm saying, something to where you're just, you know, and then when you do something like that, obviously, after a while, it's going to take the real feeling out of it because you can't keep doing the same thing. But as far as the punk rap thing, I mean, I was sitting back one day and I was thinking about, like, man, I'm ready to go in a different direction or whatever. And I was like, the whole style that I have, man, I'm like, how would I explain it? I'm sitting there watching A&E and the History of Punk Rock comes on. You know, I like some punk stuff or whatever. So I sat there and started watching it. And there were the big question throughout the whole show was, what is punk rock? What does punk rock mean? What is that? And everybody was like, well, it's this. Well, it's that. Well, it's this. And one guy just came out at the end. He was like, man, you know, their punk rock is really just doing what you want. You know what I'm saying? If you look at punks or whatever, they dress how they want to dress. The music sounds real unorganized a lot of times, but it just has a feeling to it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the actual organization just comes within not being organized. You know what I'm saying? It kind of doesn't sound as clear and crisp as other rock songs. The studio mastering and mixing is not always the best, and it's more about live performance. And that's me. That boils back down to me, like live performances, wanting to change it up, do different things. So I was like, man, it's kind of like punk. You know what I'm saying? So we'll just call it punk rock. And then that song I did, I was like, you know, just kind of used guitar effects on the voice and stuff like that. So,
and you do have,
I produced it.
You did produce.
That's why it sounds so simple, but dope.
No, I wouldn't say simple. No, I wouldn't say simple. It actually sounds pretty thick. It sounds like there's a lot. I mean, I would definitely wouldn't.
Oh man, there's probably like 20 tracks.
Okay, you know what you're talking about simple then? Where did you get that from?
Well, because most people will hear it and be like, well, you know, are we talking to?
We're talking to, I don't know who we're talking
exactly. So we're talking to everybody then.
I try to not collect statistics because I'm not trying to manipulate anybody.
Okay, well, we're not trying to be a gimmick.
Oh, no. Right. But what's up? So most people say what about it? They say it's simple?
No, I mean, if you're a music listener, right. you know, you have people like us who listen to music, and then you have people like, who hear music. Okay. And then you have people that like that just listen to it.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, you will listen to a beat or a song, and you can probably break down different sounds, sections, whatever. Yeah, you know what I'm sections. You know. And then just the music, the average listener is just going to say, okay, there's drums, and it's a cool beat. You know, it's catchy hook. So to those people, it may sound simple.
Cool.
But to somebody who knows maybe about production or whatever, they'd be like, oh, yeah, like, you know, it's got some intricacies in it.
No doubt. Yeah. I think we should take a break.
Let's do it.
Because we're going to talk more. We'll talk about how you went to the inauguration.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you actually got to take any video or not.
I did, but it was whack because the lady I was standing in front of, like, started doing this Arabic yell and bumped me and stuff, and she was just, like, losing it. I think she was catching the Holy Ghost or something. Yeah, I don't know.
But do you have that footage?
I actually do, but it's not with me.
Right, that's fresh, though.
I'll get it to you, though.
How about this? In the magic of television, we will now go to that footage.
Let's go to it.
All right. In 3, 2...
Yeah!
So that was footage of you at the inauguration of Mr. Barack Obama.
Exactly.
Yeah. And what was going on in part of that clip anyway? What was the feeling like being there?
Really, man, it was like we drove. Took us about 17 hours to get there. By the time we got there, we had to get like on their little Metrolink train thing. Rode there, took about 20 minutes, and then we were actually at the inauguration for like 8 hours. You know what I'm saying? So by the time he came out and drove down and did the thing, which he drove like really slow, he made sure he actually, I guess in a way, like made sure he paid attention to the people that came out to support him for all those hours.
No.
And got out and actually walked too. But what was going on in that clip was the motorcade was coming down and some crazy lady was behind me and was like bumping my head. But it was so much love, I couldn't even get mad at her. You know? You know what I'm saying? It was like, okay, you're bumping me in love, you're excited. Right. I'm just going to try to get a little footage so people believe that I was actually here, and that's basically what that was.
Well, we'll try and help people believe you were there by you know, spreading that video.
Right, word.
You know, so I know the video is authentic. I had it authenticated by the FBI. Who was based here in Kansas City? They got some stuff going
on. Well, actually, you know, they actually questioned me while I was taking it or right before. So
tell me about that, because I told them to ask you some questions in preparation for our interview.
I'm not sure
which questions they actually asked.
Well, the only question they asked me really was, is that your bag? And let me see that camera.
And that's exactly what I'm saying. I made sure that the FBI would authenticate that you were there with your equipment. Yeah. That way when my viewers had, our viewers had seen the footage, they would know 100% natural.
Because you can always trust the government. We both know that, right?
Well, when I'm paying their salaries, yes.
Right.
All right. Well, let's see. Let's go to another music video real quick.
Let's go to it.
This is a short part of a music video. It's my attempt at making a music video off the cuff while at the Berlin Wall. It's to a song called
The Berlin Wall, man.
Late Night Suff by Suff Daddy in Berlin. And my man Connect from Think Loud Records shouts to Leipzig, where he goes to school. Berlin Wall, Late Night Suff. Boom.
Close the street, you know, we have to pass it to go to the main station. Right. But if they want to do things like that, we will take the train also.
Alright, we'll see. Almost there. Alright, here we go. Let's just do it right now.
Awesome. Just have a look. Flash started like this, son. What do you do when you feel so right inside?
And we're back. So that was me at the Berlin Wall. It's pretty cool. And it stopped because the Polish police were nearby at this big arena, and they were looking really weird, and I don't know much about the Polish police, so I figured we better just stop.
Well, I mean, you know, my question is, I want to know how I can get to the Berlin Wall.
No doubt. And maybe the caller has the answer.
Yes, James Christos.
Hello?
James Christos.
Is anybody there? Did you pay someone to call and not pay him enough to actually talk?
Hello, wife. Hello. Okay, this must be one of those situations where she like hit my number on accident in the phone. So now I'm gonna sit here and see if she talks shit about me or whatever.
Just tell her you love her either way. That way, if she is listening, you at least get your 2 points in.
What he said.
All right. So here's one of my questions. The Kansas City news section, minus the newspapers,
okay,
which I only did in the first episode.
Right.
So far, they demolished Bannister Mall.
Demolished it?
Did you know that?
Like it's flat?
According to the news on TV I saw the other day, I've been driven by even though it's within reason, right, distance-wise. If that were to have happened a couple days ago, which I did believe it did happen, as someone who's been in Kansas City, what does that signal to you in any way? What is your reaction to that?
Totally, honestly.
Yeah. Break it down. No, I mean, I try to avoid cursing.
Oh, no.
No racism, homophobia, or cursing is kind of my policy.
It's kind of hard with a Jesus shirt on. I did let one slip already. Jesus still loves me, though. But anyway.
No doubt.
But what that means to me, I mean, I'll be totally frank with you.
Be frank. I'll be Jim.
The money is not in Southtown, Southside Kansas City. I mean, if you really want to break it down to the real, like, logistics of the whole thing, you got the African-American migration towards the south side of Kansas City and white flight and all that kind of stuff. I mean, you got to go where the money's at, and it wasn't there.
Which explains why the mall didn't work, you're saying.
Exactly.
I hear you.
Exactly.
And I don't understand that they're tearing it down probably as a media stunt to signal that they are moving forward towards this soccer proposal.
Exactly.
Which would basically bring the people in Johnson County in the south white area, basically. I mean, there's all types of people in Johnson County. Shout out to Approach. Whatever, this is going to be the soccer thing. I like soccer.
Yeah.
You know, whatever. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't care.
I'm a weird black dude to most people, so.
Well,
not to you, but see,
I'm a weird white dude, you know what I'm saying? The amount of, all right, everybody out there that wants a beat, first of all, I haven't made beats in years. Second of all, I don't know that much about rock, so quit asking me for rock beats, okay? And quit calling me shouts to Christos. what's that dude's name? What's the white producer name from Def Jam?
Oh, Rick Rubin.
The Rick Rubin of Kansas City. No, I don't mind that. I like Rick Rubin.
All right. See, the thing about it is he could be. This is a choice he's making. You see what I'm saying?
That's true.
It's a choice.
It is a choice. It is a choice.
Just like me. I mean, I made that punk rock beat. That was the first beat I made. And people are like, oh, can I get a beat? Dude, I made that for myself. Not to be selfish, but that.
No, don't be selfish.
Because every time I make one, you guys are like, that's not what I was looking for.
Hip-hop. Hip-hop. Yeah. People in hip-hop expect. And this is, I don't know what it, I mean, let's talk about it. If you do something in hip hop, people expect that you share that with them. If some female writes acoustic singer songwriter songs about, like, you know, rainbows, you don't say, hey, you play guitar, yo, write me a song real quick. You know what I'm saying? But if you make beats, you're like, yo, give me a beat.
Right.
It's like, give you a beat. That's not, I don't come to your mom's house, be like, make me some macaroni.
Right, exactly.
What is that about? I mean, it has to do probably maybe with like the spirit of like, we're in this together.
We're doing what we can with what we have,
which is the origin of hip hop. But nowadays, it's a little bit interesting. I mean, no, it's not a bad thing. It's just kind of different.
There's so much stuff out there right now, to be honest with you, man. I say this with no shame at all. You really have to be selective about who you're dealing with, because everybody can make a song now. Everybody can make a beat. So for me to make a beat and just give it to somebody, I mean, my whole thing is, what are you gonna do with it? Now, if you came to me and said, yo, and you had a certain pitch that was like, I felt that I was gonna really contribute to the culture or whatever, I'm gonna work with you. Mm-hmm. But if you're just like wanting a beat, that's not doing anything for me. Especially, you know.
Well, also the other part to say that I think most people might not recognize is that you put in so much work through trying to navigate and understand what making music, putting it out, and what the next step, basically the business, how that all formulates that you realize just having a beat from someone doesn't say anything about what's going to happen after that.
Right, and
more importantly, whether it's going to give proper potential to your creation that you're contributing.
Exactly.
All right, let's move on for a second because I don't want to lose the people who don't care about this stuff.
Oh, I'm sure they're soaking it up. This is good stuff.
I'm getting a little good feedback. There's some nonsense out there. Actually, it's not. I mean, there's nonsense everywhere. I'm nonsense.
Right.
Take back everything I said. I am nonsense. That's the nonsense to which I refer. All right. It was really warm out today.
Yeah.
This is recorded on the 22nd of January, 2009.
Right.
Katie Horner, TV weatherman, weatherwoman.
Right.
Known in Kansas City for creating false alarms.
Yeah, see.
What's up with the weather people in Kansas City? We got some dynamic weather folk around here. I'll tell you, I think they all want to be superstars. There's some competition about who has the baddest weather center, but then you go to the certain stations and their whole background is completely like green screen,
right.
Fake. They're like, they got some stations that got real weather centers.
Right.
Then
right.
Some that got fake weather centers.
Well, you know, a lot of them are just getting their information secondary anyway.
My lord. Yo, we get stories here on the news like in Nebraska, a puppy was born with like 10 nipples and no children or something, you know what I'm saying? They're like,
right.
They're like, you ever seen a really big pumpkin? Look at this one from Colorado. Let's go live to our Colorado affiliate.
To it's like County Fair.
Yo, you don't have a Colorado affiliate. You're based in Kansas City.
Exactly.
It always been that way?
I have, but my thing is, I mean, well, specifically with the weather thing, like, see, like, I have this, whatever these things are called on, and this leather coat.
Warm.
So, but it's warm outside. But I'll leave out of here, and it'll be like 20 degrees lower than what it was.
Because you're preparing, or because the weather changes because of what you wear?
You know what? I'm confused at this point. I don't know what it. I think the weather changes to make me look stupid. Like if I go outside with like some shorts on, it'll get real cold.
I am the dude though that shows up in my down coat most seasons when it's not summer. But the fact is, down in certain materials and certain garments,
right.
Regardless of what they're made out of, adjust adequately.
Right,
and
right,
some people's bodies adjust adequately.
Right.
So it's not always about, you know, people got fun making fun of me like, why are you in your ski jacket? I've never been skiing in my life practically. I've been some cross-country skiing because my dad got interested in that, but I've never been down skiing.
Right.
It's not a ski jacket. It's warm.
It's exactly.
And when it's warm outside, it's not warm. It's brilliant.
Exactly. I mean, you know, it's just about, you know, that's one thing about the Midwest. The dang weather is just like unpredictable. I've been here for all these years and I've never got used to it. So that's how it is, you know.
Well, do you have any? What are your general thoughts about Kansas City? What's the mentality around here? What's going on in Kansas City?
Well, my general sentiment towards Kansas City.
It didn't look very strong. I thought it was going to have this like distortion effect, but it just looked like
I have one
stupid.
More drink. You know what I'm saying?
No,
the
man.
Thing, my general consensus about Kansas City is, I really have a real love-hate relationship with this place. Straight up.
I think everybody does.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, it's when I come off the road, I'm glad to be here. I'm here for 2-3 months. I want to go. You know what I'm saying? I mean, Kansas City, man, I think it's just, man, it's one of those places where it's very fertile for things to take off from here, but you just don't have a lot of cultivating of what's here. Like, people always tell me all the time, they're like, you know, they'll come into the studio or something, we'll be talking, they'll be like, yeah, there's tons of talent in Kansas City, tons of talent. I'm like, there's tons of talent everywhere. I mean, but what's our infrastructure like? Who are the people that are pushing it? I mean, that's important, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, because you got places like St. Louis, just as much talent, but they have people that are like backing the artist in some type of way.
That being said, to my understanding, it's only been the last 8 years that things have really popped out of there.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, when I was in school, when I was going to CMSU.
Did you go to school with jazz?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that how you met?
No, well, we met through, because I've been knowing Jamal and them since they were like in high school.
Jazz is an engineer in Kansas City.
Yeah.
Great, you know, works with a lot of hip-hop people, other people, 64111 Clinic Studio.
Right. Yeah, man, I met them when they were in high school. I may have been my freshman year of college.
Anyway, I didn't mean to take you off track.
No, it's cool.
St. Louis, CMSU.
No, I'm just saying when I went to CMSU, when I first started, whatever, like late 90s or whatever, I mean, St. Louis was pretty much like Kansas City as far as how it was set up.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had one artist pop from there, you know, Nelly or whatever. And
Then Murphy Lee.
Well, I mean, you know, actually, you know.
I like that song. What the hook gonna be?
I like that.
Actually, you know, he just got a new thing out, and you know, DJ Shad, shouts to DJ Shad, is doing his mixtape right now.
For real?
Because he's putting something out. He just did it at the studio, my studio. I just opened, so you know, I got a little co-hosting on there, man. So I'm, you know,
Murphy Lee, I don't know him, but he seems like he's a good guy.
He's a good guy, man. I mean, he's like he doesn't profess to be like the most lyrical, or whatever. I mean, but he's good at what he does, and you know, he stays in his lane. Not saying that he can't do different things, but he does what he does. You know what I'm saying? So, and I mean,
worthwhile. Yeah. Worthwhile artist.
Yeah. He gets paid for what he does. And I'm just now starting to do that. And I've seen you've done that. You do that. And I'm trying to be like Miles when I grew up. That's all. I send him texts like that all the time.
Whatever that means.
On my Twitter, what was the first thing? The second message I put on my Twitter was, Miles Bonney is a genius. Yeah, that's what it was. I'm just learning all the Twitter well stuff and all that kind of stuff. Oh, yeah.
If you only knew how much I paid him for being on this show tonight.
Right. Yo, right.
Take this.
It reflects in the new 2002 Ford Explorer I'm driving outside with the dented back and bumper.
It's fly. If you guys have you ever seen a gold bumper? This dude has a gold bumper. It happens to have my names like in the corner because I paid for it, but it's fresh. So don't run into his gold bumper. Right. Otherwise, I'm going to sue you because I own it.
Exactly.
All right. No, I don't.
But so about Kansas City. I mean, I don't know, man. You know
what I'm saying? What are some of your restaurant recommendations?
Jack Stack Fiorella's.
For real?
Yeah.
Is Jack Stack
better than Gates?
Wow, is it a chain from outside here? Jack Stack Barbecue, that whole thing?
No, they were actually, from my understanding, started in Martin City.
Where's like, that? Missouri?
Yeah, like south, like okay. It's west of Grandview, like right before you hit the Kansas border.
Because I'm in KCK a lot, and right, I see the Jack Stack out there by the Legends, and I was thinking about looking at it that it's
man, that stuff.
Talk about it. I don't know. I've never been there.
You guys, this is the last free plug you're gonna get. Anything after that, you're going to have to pay for whatever in food or something. But they have, hands down, the best barbecue experience. Notice that experience. The food, the ambiance, yeah. I mean, everything.
What's the ambiance of Jack Stack Barbecue?
It's like eating at a high-class restaurant with, like, barbecue shack prices.
No doubt.
I mean, because they have the one on the plaza. They have the one on 19th Street. The Legends.
Yeah, yeah.
They have one down in South Kansas City. It's just, I mean, the service is great, the food is good. They actually have like a lot of meat on the bones of the ribs and stuff. And it's not just like charred.
Alright, hopefully it's not full of antibiotics and like fake growth hormones.
I don't think so, man, because it tastes kind of gamey sometimes. Like it's fresh off the you know what I'm saying?
And hopefully it's not roadkill.
All right. You start going towards Martin City, man, in Harrisonville, you might get some.
Let me tell you, when I was younger, I had an obsession with trying to buy roadkill menu t-shirts. I never bought one, but when I finally started to want to buy one, I couldn't find one.
Okay, you're on. You're the third person to call. Now you're on. You're live. Speak your mind.
Uh-oh.
My bad, bro. Man, I just got in here and realized I left this shit in the sink. My bad.
Oh, you're cussing and everything, man. About to be broadcast all over the world.
Here's my question. What was left in the sink that he or you were looking for? Did you say you left some in the sink?
Yeah.
What was in the sink?
Oh, some paint stuff.
Paint? Are you painting?
Yeah. Who is this?
This is Thomas. Thomas McIntosh. You know Thomas McIntosh. I'm an old friend, man. I'm Kansas City's greatest DJ and producer. Funk, baby. Where the 7-inch at? I'll make you some spinach dip. my treadmill broke again. Hey man, me and Super Wolf are gonna throw a fly party. You should see our reggae posters. It's just like the 70s.
This is the soon to be world famous or at least locally accepted DJ Rockwell. This is my DJ here. So, you know, he's got this ongoing project in the basement of the studio, and now he's got paint stuff in the sink, because I guess that's what sinks are for, to clean paint stuff and not to wash hands and stuff. No. So what's up? What are you looking for?
The little orange thing, man.
It's in the basement.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. What's up, yo? This is Godson.
Hey,
you got any more CDs left? I sold out. You got any more of those joints?
Yeah,
Hey, man, just look at the basement. I'm doing this thing with Miles right now, man.
You just been punked. Punk rocks.
Is anyone these boxes or something?
What?
Is anyone these boxes?
No, it's down by the side of the steps. You've just been punk rocked. Red phone.
All right. All right. Let's get back to the news. Candace, we're gonna end it soon because you know I'm trying to cut down the length of the shows, even though I haven't been very successful. Kansas City newspapers. I only bring this up, let's leave it at that. Media outlets, because something that holds back Kansas City, that does not hold back coastal cities and other larger cities, is media outlets that get across the world. If you are in California, you may have Accelerator magazine. You may have other magazines. You have, you know, Vice in other cities. You have really cool magazines that get out there. We don't have any magazines in Kansas City to get there. Ooh. Shouts to Dementia, but there's some out there that are...
Don't spare anybody. Don't spare anybody.
I'm ignorant. Here we go.
Just throw the blanket on top. Hey, it's a blanket statement, but you know, if it's true, it's true.
Break it out. What is it? You might know things that I don't know. This is why I have you on, because I need to learn too.
I think one of the main problems with that is, I don't think it's not that we don't have them. I think that a lot of the people that are behind them, Kiana, I'm doing a TV interview with Miles right now. I was trying to answer the phone, but it hung up on you. Hello?
If you need to,
What can I do for you? Hello?
I can.
Oh, yeah.
All right. I don't want to get in the way of family, you know.
Oh, no. She's going to divorce me anyway, so. I'm just joking. Let me not speak that.
Wait, I got to know though, real quick. Did I mess up? Are there other outlets here that I'm unaware of that are international?
No. I mean, no. I think we have some that have the potential, but I think a lot of the people that work for the ones that we do have, like mm-hmm. the Pitch, and you know, not Dementia yet because we pretty much got one guy working Dementia.
No. But
you know, I mean, I just think they're clinch. They're cliquish, man. You know what I'm saying? I mean, in order to be a truly a magazine or something with some kind of integrity, you have to be, what is the word, objective, I guess?
You know what I want to know? Why they never write about me, man?
Why, right.
Why can I get in that circle?
Yeah, man? Right.
You know what? I'm just trying. I agree, man, because I can never just break through.
Dude, I've been doing my thing for, I would just say business-wise, for the past 10 years, right?
Yeah.
So I'm steadily trying to knock down doors, get interviews, reviews for albums, stuff like that. I've probably put out like 4 or 5 full-length albums, countless EPs, whatever. So, you know, people got wind of this EMI thing, right? So I get calls now.
Right.
Why, though?
Who are you getting calls from?
Why?
Not names, but, like, who are you getting calls from? And maybe it's not the best business decision to shout out people didn't call you before.
I don't care. I have nothing to lose.
Handle it however you want to handle it. But my interest as an individual is, what has changed? We'll break down real quick in, like, 5 seconds the EMI situation.
EMI, I just signed a digital distribution deal with EMI for my label, Gorilla Movement. I'm the first project to come out. Punk Rock and No Words, the first single coming out. The album will be out in the late spring, early summer.
Does the album have a name?
Punk Rap.
2 words. By James Christos. No doubt. Just, you know, because they got to get their Google iTunes search on.
That's it. You know, and yeah, do that.
Punk Rap is an album coming out in 2009 by James Christos.
iTunes, Yahoo, Rhapsody, you know, different things on EMI or EMI Gracie.
Can I leave a promo drop for it right now?
Go ahead.
What's up? This is Miles Bonney, and you're listening to my man James Christos. Punk Rap, Snap Your Neck.
You know what? You just gave me part of the concept for the album. I'm going to do a whole album. It's going to be punk rap, but it's going to have a mixtape feel to it because it's going to have drops on it.
No doubt. Can I be the only person that combined slap and snap in a word? I don't think anybody else is going to want to combine those.
You've got it, man. You've got it.
I'm an idiot. All right, so we talked about some restaurants. Congratulations on the EMI thing. And I'm curious, because I'm in the biz. Digital distribution deal.
Yes.
Is EMI doing physical at all with anybody? They might have some because they still do classical and stuff that people buy CDs. It's a weird time for CDs.
No, really. To get technical about it, which some people may understand, I have a part of the contract is done on a sliding scale. Which means so many units pushed through this avenue, then we'll open this avenue.
No doubt.
You do.
It builds upon it.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? 10,000 here. We'll go here. You know what I'm saying? And really, right, what we're working off right now is just a single. Mm-hmm. So the kind of numbers I'm working with is, you know, 10,000, downloads of a certain single.
No doubt.
Will option for full physical CD besides just the digital distribution of the CD, but full physical CD. But I also have the option in my contract to have somebody else distribute the physical CD, which was smart on my move because I've been doing this too long to be dumb.
No doubt. I was going to ask that question. I mean, was there some back and forth?
Oh yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah. I mean, I'm 80% of revenue received from the sales, 50% publishing deal with EMI. So when they work for commercial, whatever, it's a 50-50 split. But, you know, I don't know how to talk to Nike, so I figured I'd give that up to them. You know what I'm saying? So stuff like that, all those different things, I pretty much worked in my favor.
No doubt.
Yeah.
Maybe someday I'll be able to gain from your knowledge.
I think you have, because I think you're going places that I haven't been, because I really want to know how I can get over to Europe.
All right.
How can a man such as myself, with the pending project I have, make the right connections to do as Miles?
My understanding of that, which is minimal, would be to work with any European labels. Granted, EMI, at this point, they probably have an exclusive, I would assume, mm-hmm. an exclusive agreement with you for a period of time and or for a project or two,
right.
under which you can't work with other labels.
Right.
But if you can ever get to the point where you start working with more international labels, like I worked with a Japanese label for Sounds Good, and
right.
we didn't get to go to Japan.
Right.
But and I will say that me going to Europe had nothing to do with my German label specifically,
right.
because although they were very gracious and I spent time with them and he was a great host, I was actually brought up by another individual
right.
Who happened to be in the same country. But I don't know, man. I think the international music scene is, in terms of, it's not necessarily international music scenes. That's kind of an absurd statement. But, mm-hmm. I mean, I didn't plan it.
but you've achieved it now. We all know once you do something once, you know, you might not be able to do it easy the next time, but you have more knowledge.
You know what I'll say? I will say like this. Going to Europe is no different than going to New York or LA. It's a plane ticket. You know, once you
yeah, but I want to get paid in pounds and euros and not dollars.
No doubt. I mean, just, you know, I don't know, man. I mean, I don't have the answer, but I would say if I had no clue, given the knowledge I have about having done it, think about artists that you feel like you are somewhat on par with business-wise, as well as sales-wise, as well as acclaim-wise, or music style-wise. Find out who's bringing them out there.
Right.
And try and get on those avenues. I mean, there was I think the number one tour agency out there, I believe I learned while there, is called Sabotage.
Okay.
They bring, I think, a lot of the big independent hip hop artists, like the big ones.
Okay, right.
I'm not going to name names, but that's how I understood. And I didn't know that previous to going there, and they didn't bring me.
Okay.
But I don't know. I mean, I say pay attention to people's tour schedules, and especially mm-hmm. if there's people you have interactions with and they're going out there, figure out who brings them.
Right.
Because although in some ways you will be competition, because if someone brings you, they might not bring that artist.
Right.
If it's a
right.
similar period.
Right.
You know, it doesn't hurt to ask. You know what I mean?
Word up. I'm on it.
All right. Well, let's say, what else does James Christos want to say to the public out there that knows him, that doesn't know about him, in kind of wrapping up before we get to some listening of musics towards the end of the show? How can they check what you do out? You know, they gotta connect the dots.
I'm real lame. I have a MySpace page. That's pretty much it. I got people right now working on a website and everything, but I'm really like a control freak somewhat when it comes to my material. So the label was like, yo, we got some people that will set up. Like, I was like, no, how about I just deal with the people I deal with here, and then if it's okay with you guys, if it looks good, we'll run with it, because I want to be able to deal with people that I can kind of actually physically go see, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? So myspace.com/JamesChristos, JamesChristos. Twitter me or whatever. What is my thing?
Twitter's fresh.
Yes, Twitter. Man, it's dope, because I was, man, I mean, just the back and forth, you know what I'm saying?
It's like an ongoing chat between
exactly.
everybody that you're following and yourself.
Exactly.
It's an abstract thing, but
it's like a room full of people just, you know, not like a chat room, but
yeah,
it's
no,
just,
no.
you know, yeah.
It's definitely like you're Twitter. You're in like a room and there's all these people talking, and
right.
you just kind of, if you care about people talking about, you join, and if not, you go right. find what other people are talking about. You create
exactly.
your own conversation.
Yeah, I like it. And then Facebook, of course. All this stuff is James Christos.
I will
keep it
say Facebook and Twitter are taking over MySpace. It's down the drain.
I'm getting led to believe that, but like, I've been on Facebook, and Facebook is like too complicated for me, so I'm trying to learn
you
how to work
doubt.
It.
I agree, man. I got a learning curve, and I thought I mastered some joints with Facebook for a minute. Or MySpace. Now I'm
right.
lost.
Right.
Well, I will finish up real quick. The Doors influence on your MySpace page. Do you have a favorite Doors song or album, or what is your interest in the Doors?
The Doors.
Only because I like the Doors, but I don't know much about them.
I would say, why would you bring that up, man? Because,
why?
Man, I mean...
I don't know that much of Doors, but I feel a connection to them. And if I was more focused, I'd probably spend a week or so listening to more Doors.
That whole LA's 60 beach slash psychedelic thing, I love that, man. I mean, you know what I'm saying? That's what I kind of like drink to when I'm by myself.
So there's other albums or other artists you like around this. Is it the sound, the feel? Is it a specific song,
just
album?
That, just the feel specifically that the Doors have. I mean, the Doors influence on me. Let me say Jim Morrison, man.
What's up with the Jim Morrison? He has some solo stuff that was like spoken word. There's some stuff going on that was a little wacky towards the end, as I understood
it. I've only heard one that my dad had.
Did you?
I can't really remember how it went. Because my dad's a big fan of the Doors and stuff like that. So, but, I mean, is frontman wise? I mean,
No.
I mean, if I would pattern myself after anybody, you know, in that genre of music, it would be somebody like him. I mean, somebody that could just really just raise the emotion in the listeners and everything. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. I'm just not going to be jumping off of no Ruse, no Lizard Kings, no nothing like that.
So. See, I've heard Lizard. I don't even know what that means. I heard Lizard King. All right,
I won't be getting arrested in Florida for it or wherever it was at for none of that stuff.
So. I have two public service announcements. One, library cards are great, very valuable.
Yes. If I keep up with mine, I'd probably use it.
Get a library card. They're free. Also, Cornell West is going to be a UMKC tomorrow, which is really probably a couple days ago as you're watching this. But
that's my frat brother, and I'm going to have to go to that.
Yeah, it's tomorrow UMKC. Yeah, okay. I'm very excited. I mean, he's kind of, you know, I don't agree with everything. Right. Not that it matters what I agree with, but he's brilliant. It's free, dog.
At UMKC? What time?
About 6.
I'm
going
to have to go there.
Yeah. You might have to call him or something tomorrow. Or something. Okay. I don't know. Okay. Bum rush the show or something. All right, well, let's go listen to some records.
Let's do it.
We've had some DJs in the past. Obviously, they have records. Christos, I'm sure, has lots of music at home.
But you hit me at the last minute. I was going to bring my Public Enemy record, but
no doubt. Well, it's mad last minute. I apologize. You know, you'll be back on at some point trying to bring the cycle. And we're going to get to some non-hip-hop artists here in a minute. Nothing against hip-hop. But in the coming shows. My sister's going to be on. My wife's going to be on. And other white non-people, hip-hop people. So I've only had black people on so far. Okay. I'm going to play some records. And I thought that...
Do it.
And I hesitate to because I'm kind of greedy. You know, DJs like to have their joints and no one else has.
Right.
Not to say that I'm the one who has them, but I want to present it in the right time. But I don't really have the platform to present it.
Okay.
This is my platform. I'm going to play some joints. And I want to get some Christo's response. How about that organization? Any last things you want people to know about Christo's or reason why you do what you do that you want them to know is like where you're coming from?
I just love to create,
you know.
I'm gonna make music and create till I die, man. It's just what I love doing, man. I mean, the minute I walked off that 9-to-5, I just felt free, and that's what I'm doing now, is providing for me and my family. I love doing it. I love helping other people, and that's what I look forward to doing in the future. I definitely want to be an avenue for helping other artists and just people in general in the community live out their dreams. So if I could say anything, that's what I'd say. Word.
Now that I'm going to be there in about 20 minutes. Jamel's there right now. Rockwell's there right now if you want to go right now, but I'll be there right after you. Okay. Gunjack.
Tell Gunjack what's up.
Crazy whack Gunjack.
Dude is mad at me, I think.
I don't know, man. He's mad at everyone. That's why I gotta,
we're recording right now, just so you know. No doubt.
Oh, it doesn't matter.
All right, no doubt. Is that fresh? It's all good. He knows it.
Yeah. Oh, I'll tell him. He knows.
Love you, Gunjack. And I'm not rich off your album. Believe that. Here we go. This joint is fresh. I need the light, huh? Give me the light. I think I twittered about this one. Is that light all messed up? I don't care. It's the best I can do. Here we go. This album, Christos, is Eloy, something like that. This lighting situation is kind of wacky. Anyway, Silent Cries and Mighty Echoes. Okay. I'll hand you the artwork.
Word.
I will play some records. And this is just kind of too beautiful to sample. You know what I mean? Let's let it ride. Dude's English is brilliant.
Huh.
Some people call it prog rock. I call
prog
it
rock.
What it is.
Now we gotta find out that summer's evening's gone. We live a daydream, embracing home. Now we gotta wake up. Do we really think the world to be a creative oversight? Do we really think of senseless power? But forces we reveal, expose the true essence of things, the reason of all that has come to existence. No more silent cries will be able to divide it all. We're lonely in the nights. Frequencies of truth.
Pardon me, I stopped the record because I realized this is on EMI, so if Christos wants this next upcoming part, which is the reason why I'm playing it, in addition to the dude's brilliant English and voice, he can apparently have that greater access to it, because this is fresh, but we'll get his reaction ever afterwards.
We're calling for us. When we ever find out what means to be, will we spread it out? The day we see, while we exploring thousand mighty minds in the lost newborn, only true kingdom.
Here we go. Time.
Morning and appearance. Forests will explode in on with wings. Spirits will ascend into the sky. Cities will catch fire and the carbonized sun is hot and dry.
burn the air and be afraid of our mother frame. The serial we are, the air we breathe, the stone that's stirring up our fire. I see our life and limb will still not come to harm at the moment. That's the reason why we still think of everything to be alright. But our hidden swords already fell in seas of flames with our solution.
See you next episode, y'all. Peace to James Christos. Thanks for coming, man.
No doubt.